As part of what we do at Wine Intelligence, we collect consumer insight from 34 global primary wine markets. We had, as always in January, planned our regular March collection, not really realizing, like many of us, I guess at that time, quite how globally impacted so many markets and each and every one of us would be by the time March arrived. So with our consumer survey, we very quickly added in additional questions to consumers to find out from them how they were immediately changing their wine consumption behavior during end of March and April, how they were predicting they would feel, they would behave, they would drink post-lockdown and post, as we termed it in the survey, immediate danger of virus. When we carefully looked at the analysis and the tracking from our data, was actually there was remarkable stability and consistency on the measures we would expect, but there were also the expected changes. Really important to measure frequently with consumers because they can tell us about what they're doing now, but that also helps us predict what they might be doing in the future. They also tell us what they think they'll do in the future. It is valid and reliable from a data perspective to collect data and measure what we call sentiment. How are consumers feeling? So let's move in to have a look at what consumers are telling us about, firstly, what they did during lockdown, as we were collecting the data, as I said, in early sort of end March into early April. And I guess most importantly for all of us, what they're planning on doing or anticipating they will do when it comes to wine, but also bigger picture in terms of lifestyle in the future. So at a broader level, the first question, how did category purchase change during lockdown? So if we look at wine, still wine, champagne and other sparkling, spirits, beer, we can see clusters, we're not surprised to see clusters and patterns of behaviour. Consumers pretty much in every market were drinking either the same during that lockdown period as they had prior, or in some markets, so in the UK, the US and China, actually increased their overall frequency of wine consumption. Champagne, we can see very clearly dropping. Spirits, again, typically reduction in overall frequency of consumption. Beer, actually pretty static. And we all purchased bottled water more often during lockdown than we had done previously. So the line you see across the middle of the chart here is the typical behaviour prior to the kind of lockdown impact of COVID. How frequently was wine being consumed in all of these markets? And the first dot you see, March 2019, we were asking consumers here their behaviour up to that point. So it's really kind of pre-major impact of virus. And then the March, April 2020 lockdown behaviour was how they were actually the immediate behaviour they were doing during this lockdown period. So here we can see overall the average frequency of wine consumption. And remarkably, actually, in Australia, UK and US, they have the average frequency of consumption is pretty similar. It's, you know, 9-10 in all three markets. And who changed their wine drinking in those markets? So what we see here, so we've divided drinkers, regular wine drinkers in each of these markets by their age. So we have legal drinking age up to age 24. So that's what we call Gen Z, our lovely millennials that we talk a lot about. Gen X, who are 40 to 55, and then 55 plus is our boomers and seniors. And we can see some patterns of behavior. So this is within market drinkers, regular wine drinkers of what age, how were they changing? But overall, the pattern is actually proportionally Gen Z, so our youngest drinkers, reduced their frequency of wine consumption the most. Millennials and Gen X, so our mid-age groups, sort of mid-market age groups, tended in most cases, along with China, actually to increase their frequency of wine drinking. But over to the right-hand side of the chart, the boomers and the seniors, with a little exception in the UK, just marginal increase, actually that's where the frequency was decreased. And how did drinking occasions change during lockdown? The proportion of consumers who increased drinking wine for a relaxing drink at the end of the day increased pretty much everywhere. And typically, the pattern was to decrease the amount of wine consumption that was happening with an informal meal. But what we did find that wine was increasingly turned to as the drink of choice for non-food occasions. So actually, that's a really interesting positioning for wine. And of course, it wouldn't be right to talk about COVID impact and occasions if we didn't talk about our sort of new lockdown occasion. It was an occasion before lockdown, but certainly one that has increased significantly, which is the consumption of wine when catching up with friends or family online or on the phone. We've seen an increase in the frequency of those occasions. And what happened to spend? Well, during lockdown, with the exception of China, you'll see these arrows going down. This is an indexed change. So this means that it's proportionally how did typical spend go up or down during lockdown versus those individual consumers' typical spend prior to lockdown. And what we can see is most consumers reduced their typical spend. And so we're switching from those sort of some special occasion wines where we spend more and having a higher proportion of what consumers would call everyday wines. So proportionally, their typical spend on average comes down. And then purchasing online. What's interesting is to get this into perspective of, well, where was there more online purchasing before and where was there less? Clearly, overall, China was a market that proportionally had a very high percentage of proportionally online wine consumption at around 50% of consumers, compared with the US, where that's much smaller as a proportion, 10, 11% of consumers, not dissimilar in Australia. And if we look at who increased their online wine purchasing during lockdown, so who have we got the potential to engage with in the future, depending on which market, between 55 and 65% of those who increased their online shopping for wine during lockdown were men. Between 40 and 65%, depending on the market, were younger, so Gen Z and millennials. And around half, 55 to just to nearly two thirds of them, were high involvement with wine. So what we didn't do was bring in less frequent wine drinkers or less involved wine drinkers. It's what we call the committed wine drinker who, as a way of accessing wine, switched more to buying it online. So here, what we asked, this is US data. So I'm just showing you data from US consumers now. And what we see here is the green sort of above the line is the proportion of consumers who say, I am actively buying more wine from this place. The red underneath is the proportion of people who are saying, I'm actively, deliberately buying less wine from this place. Typically around 70 to 80% of consumers are saying, actually, I haven't changed. So the future, what does the future hold? Are people going to go to a pub or bar or a restaurant? Again, we see more positives, certainly to the restaurants, but interestingly, pretty different opinion in the UK, US and Australia in terms of consumers feeling like or their current perception that they're going to return to the restaurant environment. Bars and pubs, pretty similar pattern. Staying in hotels for business or pleasure, again, obviously really important to us in the wine sector and then drinks. The anticipation from consumers is they're not returning to hotels at the same levels that they were before, even when that's available. Same goes for sporting events. Again, are South Korea more positive in anticipation of this? To a certain extent, China, and lesser extent, Japan. But, you know, big countries with big sport attendance, and in these countries, there's not that anticipation of returning to be able to do that. And then future priorities, some good news. In terms of wine, consumers in all markets say, yep, I'm actually going to treat myself to better quality wine. But ways of making us feel a bit special in a time which doesn't feel a bit special. And that is about treating to better quality wine, trying new alcoholic beverages, or trying new styles of food. Consumers anticipate that they will be doing that more frequently. So finishing off, this is part of some new and ongoing work. So I'm just sharing with you the sort of starting point. What we've done is we've segmented wine drinkers in all of our markets based on how they anticipate their behavior will be in the future. So we've got four segments. Varies the proportion of these that are in each market. So these are people who actually, they're hedonists. They anticipate they're going to increase their social activity and lifestyle post-lockdown. Majority of consumers, with the exception of South Korea, so near 50% in most markets, are moderators. They're anticipating some lifestyle changes, but not overall changing things like wine consumption. Reducers, they're imagining they're going to significantly curtail their lifestyles and social lives post-lockdown. And then our halters. These are people that are basically saying it's stopping my social life, my activities, my lifestyle as I knew it before. I am not anticipating it to come back. So some final thoughts to leave you with. Things to think about from a marketing point of view, whether you're a country association, regional association, or whether you're a brand owner, distributor, or retailer. Focus on core drinkers. We know that the core drinkers are the ones that have increased their frequency of wine consumption the most. Same goes for core brands. This is not a time, and certainly going into recession, which we are, where consumers are typically looking for lots of new, different, and innovative. Known brands are where consumers typically are. However, there is room for some innovation and NPD, but that must focus on relevant benefits. Continue your marketing spend, whoever you are. Overall, increasing your marketing spend increases your share of voice as other people reduce it. So your marketing spend is more effective now than those same dollars would have been 6 months ago. And finally, avoid promotional discounts. You know, if you drop the prices, they will stay there in the minds of your customers and in the minds of your consumers. So are there tactical ways you can work around that at the moment, particularly if you're a producer and brand owner, in terms of fighter brands or additional SKUs or SKUs with related labels and names to service your customers, but not put yourself in a position going forward where those price point expectations are low. So there we go.